Let us pray.
Our Father, we thank you because you brought us here tonight, and we know that you are here in our midst. We're praying that you'll bless everyone here tonight in Jesus' name. We're looking up to you for great, mighty blessings. And I pray that you'll bless all the people that are here tonight in Jesus' name. Open the windows of heaven. Shower your blessings upon your people. In Jesus' name, I pray. I'll be talking to you on faith during famine. There is a famine going on in the land. The country is going through a period of austerity, a period of need. Many individuals and many families are going through a period of poverty, need, scarcity, and hunger. That's what we call a famine. And yet, if you will have faith in God during this time of the famine, I believe that according to the promises of God, which will never fail, God will provide and meet all your needs in Jesus' name. Look at Genesis chapter 12. I want to show you from the scriptures that the problem of famine has been a problem for many, many years. Genesis chapter 12, verse 10. And there was a famine in the land, and Abraham went down into Egypt to sojourn there, for the famine was grievous in the land. Here at the time of Abraham, there was a famine, and we're told that Abraham was even affected. And since that time, there have been occurrences of famines in many parts of the world, and yet God has always provided for his own. Another time of famine we read about is in Genesis chapter 41 from verse 55. And when all the land of Egypt was famished, the people cried to Pharaoh for bread. And Pharaoh said unto all the Egyptians, go unto Joseph, what he saith to you, do. At this time of famine, the people behaved in the natural way. They went to the king, thinking that the king would be able to supply their need. But the king directed them to Joseph. We learn in our own lives, there are people that will look up to the king, or to a governor, or to a ruler, or to a president. But Pharaoh directed the people to a man that had the Spirit of God, the anointing of God, and the revelation of the Almighty with him. And that's the same thing we're telling you, that at this time of need, scarcity, and poverty, that you need to be directed to where prayer can be offered and where prayer will be answered. You need a man of revelation. You need a man of God's power. You need a man with the anointing of God, so that your problem of poverty will be taken out of the way. We're told in verse 56, and the famine was over all the face of the earth. And Joseph opened all the storehouses and sold unto the Egyptians. And the famine waxed sore in the land of Egypt. And all the countries came into Egypt to Joseph for to buy corn, because that the famine was so sore, so grievous, so terrible in all the lands. And you need to realize, God always has his own servant filled with the Spirit of God in every generation and in every place where people are suffering. And if you are in any suffering like that, as the suffering is national and it covers many cities and many homes, you need to understand that God has a way to take all the problems of poverty in your life away. And I believe he'll take it away. and he'll give you and meet all the needs of your life in the name of Jesus. In Luke chapter 4, verse 25, but I tell you of the truth, many widows were in Israel in the days of Elias, that is of Elijah, when the heaven was shut up 3 years and 6 months, when great famine was throughout all the land. Jesus also talked about the time of Elijah, when there was a great famine, and the widow of Sarephath had the provision of the Lord through Elijah, the man of God. Every time there has been a famine in the Bible, God has always raised up a man after his own heart, a prophet with his own spirit and power, so that that prophet or that man of God will pray for the people, and the need and the hunger and the sufferings of their lives will be taken away. Then I need to tell you that Jesus prophesied that in the last days that there will be a time of famine. And you need to understand that we're in the last days already, and the famine we're experiencing is something that Jesus Christ himself had spoken about. And if you realize that, you'll know that the solution is in the hand of the Lord to take away whatever problem or need you are going through at present. In Matthew chapter 24, we read about the prophecy of the Lord Jesus Christ that at the time of the end, it will be a time of need, a time of famine, a time of scarcity. And since Jesus spoke about it, and it is happening today, you need to look up to God in faith, praying and believing that the Lord will solve the problem for you. And if you have faith in God, definitely he will remove the problem, because he will never fail. Look at Matthew chapter 24 from verse 3. And as they sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, tell us, when shall these things be? Or what shall be the sign of thy coming, or of the end of the world? And Jesus answered and said unto them, take heed that no man deceive you, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that ye be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in diverse places. You can see the prophecy that Jesus spoke out. He said there shall be famines. He spoke about other things as well. He said there will be deceivers all over the world. And you know there are deceivers today that try to sell religion. They commercialize religion, but they only deceive. And Jesus spoke about many people that will rise up and say that they are Christ, deceiving many. He spoke about wars and rumors of wars. But then he said there will be famine, there will be pestilences, there will be earthquake, and in diverse places. But he says, if you are a believer, your heart should not be troubled. The point I wanted you to see there is that there is a prophecy that in the last days, and these are the days we're living now, that there will be famine that will cover many parts of the world. And you're seeing that today. In Mark chapter 13, from verse 4, Mark chapter 13 from verse 4. Tell us, when shall these things be? And what shall be the sign when all these things shall be fulfilled? And Jesus answering began to say, take heed, lest any man deceive you. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. And when ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars, be ye not troubled. For such things must need be, but the end shall not be yet. That means the very final day has not come, for the end is approaching. For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. And there shall be earthquakes in diverse places. Listen to this. And there shall be famines and troubles. Famines and troubles. These are the beginnings of sorrows. Again, Jesus spoke out that very near the time of the end, in the last days, that there will be a time of famine. You, the believer, shall have confidence in God that whatever hunger, whatever austerity, whatever poverty we see today in Nigeria, in Africa, in different parts of the world, and the inflation that is international, that is, that goes on all over the world, it is something that Jesus spoke about. And you must realize that if Jesus spoke about it, he must have made provision for his own people, for the disciples, and for the believers. What Matthew recorded, and Mark also wrote down, Luke has also given us a record of the prophecy of Jesus Christ, of the prediction of Jesus Christ, that a time of famine will come in the last days. In Luke chapter 21, reading from verse 7, and he asked him, saying, Master, but when shall these things be, and what sign will there be when these things shall come to pass? And he said, take heed that ye be not deceived, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and the time draweth near. Go ye not therefore after them. But when ye shall hear of wars and commotion, be not terrified, for these things must first come to pass, but the end is not by and by. Then said he unto them, nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and great earthquakes shall be in diverse places, and famines and pestilences, and fearful sights and great signs shall there be from heaven. Here again, Luke recorded that during the time of the last days, at the closing days of the end time, that there will be a time of need, a time of trouble, a time of famine, a time of commotions. But at such a time, there are many people that will listen to the devil, because the devil brings suggestions to people whenever there is a period of need, a period of hunger, a period of scarcity, a period of poverty. And the pity is that many people listen to the devil. And as they listen to the devil, then their problems increase. I want to show you first the suggestions that the devil will make. And then you will make sure that you do not listen to the suggestions of the devil, so that you depend upon the Lord and rely upon the Lord. And the Lord will take all the problems away from your life in Jesus' name. Look at the suggestions of the devil. In Matthew chapter 4, I'm reading from verse 2. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterward and hungered. And when the tempter came to him, he said, if thou be the Son of God, command these stones that they be made bread. Here the devil came in. He knew that there was hunger. He knew that there was no food. And the devil immediately brought this suggestion, even to the Lord Jesus Christ, and said, if you will turn the bread, the stone into bread, then you will be able to eat and meet all your need. I want to tell you that at such a difficult time like this, when there is need, when there is poverty all over the nation, the devil will be coming with various suggestions that you go your own way, you follow a carnal method, and you follow a devilish way and forsake the ways of the Lord. But the Lord Jesus refused the devil. He rejected what the devil was saying. And if you too will resist the devil, I'm telling you that the blessing of God will come upon your life. But you know, if you obey the devil and you give in to the suggestions of the devil, then the blessing that God wanted to give in your life, you will be denying yourself of that blessing. Look at verse 8. Again, the devil taketh him up into an exceeding high mountain, and showeth him all the kingdoms of the world and the glory of them, and saith unto him, all these things will I give thee, if thou wilt fall down and worship me. Another suggestion of the devil. He knew that Jesus had a need, a physical need at that time, and he said, if you'll just bow down to me and worship me, I will give you all the glories of the kingdoms of this world. And in the need in your own life, if there is famine in your family, if there is scarcity or need or poverty in your life, the devil will come. Why not worship the devil? That's what he will say. Why not go to the abbeys? That's what he will say. Why not go to the shrines? That's what he will say. Why not go to the bad beach? That's what he will say. But you know, Jesus Christ refused and rejected the temptation of the devil. In verse 10, then said Jesus unto him, get thee hence, Satan, for it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. And after the Lord had overcome the devil's temptation like that, the angels came and they ministered to him. And when you refuse the temptation of the devil, when you reject the suggestions of the devil, it is only then that your victory will come. It's only then that your provision will come. It's only then the abundance from heaven will come unto you. In verse 10, then the devil leaveth him, and behold, angels came and ministered unto him. There are people that will take the carnal suggestions of their own mind at the time of a famine. In Ruth chapter 1, reading from verse 1. Ruth chapter 1, verse 1. Now it came to pass in the days when the judges ruled that there was a famine in the land. A famine in the land. And a certain man of Bethlehem, Judah, went to sojourn in the country of Moab, he and his wife and his two sons. He left the place of the presence and the power of God, Bethlehem, Judah, and he went to a strange land. That was a suggestion of his own mind. It was not the will of God. There are people, whenever there is problem of retrenchment, problem of hunger, problem of need, problem of scarcity, then they will take to their own mind. They will not worship the Lord anymore. They go to a strange land where there is no worship of the true God. And this man did that. He went with his wife and with his two sons. We're told in verse 3, and Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died, and she was left and her two sons. Verse 5, and Mahlon and Chilion died also, both of them. And the woman, that is Naomi, was left of her two sons and her husbands. The husband died, the two sons died, because the man had followed carnal steps of unbelief. And so the devil will be bringing a lot of suggestions to you at a time of famine, at a time of need. But listen to God. Listen to the word of God. And believe the word of God. And the Lord himself will establish you, and he will provide for you in Jesus' name. At a time of famine, at a time of need, what does God want you to do? 2 Chronicles chapter 20. 2 Chronicles chapter 20. There is a time of need in Judah. And Jehoshaphat began to pray. He called all the Israelites together. He reminded God of the promise of the Lord, verses 8 and 9, and they dwelt therein, and have built thee a sanctuary therein for thy name, saying, if, when evil cometh upon us, as the sword, judgment, or pestilence, or famine. The children of Israel realized pestilence may come, famine may come. What were they to do? Were they to take the suggestions of the devil? No. Were they to take the suggestions of their carnal mind? No. What were they to do? And we stand before this house in thy presence, for thy name is in this house, and cry unto thee in our affliction. Then thou wilt hear and help. Let me interpret that verse of scripture to you. Solomon built a temple. The temple he built was according to the will of God, because God had given the pattern by the Spirit of God unto David. And David handed it over unto Solomon. And he said, my son Solomon, be strong and of a perfect heart, and go ahead and build the sanctuary and temple for the Lord. And Solomon eventually took some years and built that temple. After the building of the temple, he began to pray. And as he prayed, he said, O Lord, this is the temple that you have shown by your own mighty revelation unto my father David. Then he said, if when evil will come upon your people Israel, the sword, the judgment, the pestilence, or the famine, if we stand before you in this house, in your presence, because your name is in this house, and cry unto thee in our affliction, then you will hear, then you will help. And God sent down the glory and the cloud. And God spoke from the cloud, and he said, God will hear the prayer that the people will pray. And Jehoshaphat reminded God of those words of Solomon and the reply of God himself. After Jehoshaphat had done that, then he said in verse 20, and he rose early in the morning and went forth in the wilderness of Tekoa. And as they went forth, Jehoshaphat stood and said, hear me, O Judah, and ye inhabitants of Jerusalem, believe in the Lord your God, and so shall ye be established. Believe his prophets, so shall ye prosper. Believe his prophets, and so shall ye prosper. At a time of famine, you need the prophet of God, the man of God, a person with anointing and power, a person with the overflowing measure of the Spirit of God, to speak the word of revelation to you. Believe that prophet, believe that man of God, and you will prosper. Pharaoh had famine coming upon the nation, and God sent a man with the Spirit of God in that land, and he spoke to them, and they believed that prophet of God, they believed that man with revelation, and when they believed, they prospered. At the time of Samaria, there was a terrible famine, and a man of God, Elisha, the prophet, was there. He spoke, those who believed, they were prospered. They saw the provision of the Lord. And all through the Bible days, whenever a famine arose, the king has never been able to make any provision, or president, or governor, or ruler. But the Lord has always sent his man, his prophet, his servant, with anointing and revelation. And if you believe what that man of God is saying from the Lord unto you, you will prosper according to the word of God. Let's see the promise of God at the time of famine in Job chapter 5. Job chapter 5, verse 20 and verse 22. In famine, he shall redeem thee from death, and in war, from the power of the sword. 22, at destruction and famine, thou shalt laugh. Neither shalt thou be afraid of the beasts of the earth. You can see the promises of the Lord there, that at the time of famine, the Lord will make great provision for you. Psalm 33. From verse 18 and verse 19. Behold, the eye of the Lord is upon them that fear him, upon them that hope in his mercy, to deliver their soul from death and to keep them alive in famine. Those are the promises of the Lord during the time of famine. But the promises of the Lord are made to those who fear him, those who will believe his word, those who will follow after him. And I challenge you. And in fact, for some weeks now, we've been seeing the unprecedented power of God moving in our midst. And I want to tell you that if you will take the challenge that God is giving to you in this church, maybe you are coming for the first time, but here you are tonight, and the Lord is giving you a challenge. Maybe you have been coming before, but you have not been regular, and the Lord is giving you a challenge. And if you believe the word of God, spoken from the man of God, as I read to you, if you believe that word, you will prosper in Jesus' name. It says, the eye of the Lord is upon them that fear him, upon them that hope in his mercy, that he will deliver you from death, and that he will keep you alive in famine. I'm challenging you that you'll make up your mind, if you have not been born again, that you'll come to the Lord. You know, the person that is living in sin doesn't fear God. Because if you fear God, if you honor God, if you respect God, if you are reverencing God, you will not live in sin. You'll have the fear of God within you that will want to depart from evil. But the promise of God is for those that fear him. And I'm calling upon you and challenging you to repent of your sin so that the blessing of God will come upon your life. It says in Psalm 37, verses 18 and 19, the Lord knoweth the days of the upright, and their inheritance shall be forever. They shall not be ashamed in the evil time, and in the days of famine they shall be satisfied. In the days of famine, they shall be satisfied. That's if, according to verse 18, you are upright. And so if you have not been upright, if you have been living in sin, you need to repent. You need to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. When that change has come upon your life, then the promise of the Lord at the time of famine will be fulfilled for you. That in the days of famine, you will be provided for, you will be satisfied. The Lord Jesus Christ himself gave a parable of a young man that experienced a great need at the time of famine. And he gave this parable so as to teach you a lesson that if you are a sinner or you are a backslider and you have gone far away from the fold, you have gone far away from the people of God, you have gone far away from the presence of God, then you can come back, you can repent of all your evil ways, and you can tell the Lord the needs of your life. And as you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, he will fulfill the need of your life and he will provide for you. In Luke chapter 15, this may be your picture. You've misused your life. You've gone far into sin. You have not surrendered yourself to Jesus. You have gone away from the family of God. You have gone away from the protection that God the Father offers. And you have gone into the far country. And you have spent your life in riotous living. Now there is need. Now there is a famine. Now there is resentment. Now there is poverty. And you are in want. But you know this young man? He said in verse 18, I will arise and go to my father, and will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee. The Lord is expecting that if you want him to provide for you, but you know you have been in sin, you need to repent. The Bible asks a question. It says, can we continue in sin that grace may abound? The answer is, God forbid. If you are still living in sin, the windows of heaven will not open for you. If you are still living in sin, the prosperity will not flow into your life. But this young man decided, I will arise. I will go to my father. I will plead with my father. I will beg for his mercy. I've turned away from my sin, and I will confess to him so that he will receive me back. In verse 21, and his son said unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and I'm no more worthy to be called thy son. He confessed his lost condition, but the father received him. We're told, but the father said unto his servants, bring forth the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet, and bring thither the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. Then, as the father received the son, he also blessed him abundantly. The same thing when you turn away from your sin of fornication, your sin of adultery, your sin of evil habits, your drunkenness, your smoking, your worldliness, your polygamy, as you turn away from all the evils in your life and say, Lord, I come back home. You backslider, you say, Lord, I come back home. The sinner says, yes, I come to Christ. Then the Lord will have mercy upon you, and the Lord will bless you tremendously. But I'll challenge you, if you are not a coward, if you are bold, and you are going to take a stand for the Lord Jesus Christ, I'm telling you to come back home and to come to God and come to the family of God like the prodigal son did, and say, I will arise and go. And I will tell God, I have sinned, and I've come short of your glory. Now I want to come back home. I want my sins to be forgiven. And that means that you will promise the Lord, you will not remain in that far country. If you have been going to that shed at the bar beach and rolling on the ground and praying and saying some things and calling the names of angels and burning candle and burning incense and wearing white garment, I'm talking to those who are bold. For those who are cowards, who are saying, well, if I leave that place, what will I do? I can't talk to those people. But I'm talking to those people that they want to receive Jesus as their personal savior. I thank God many years ago when I received, when I had the message of the gospel. I wasn't a coward. I rose up, I said, oh yes, I want the gospel. I threw away the white garment. I threw away the candles. I threw away the incense. I threw away all those evil things. I said, yes, I will receive Jesus as my personal savior. That boldness has kept me until today. If I was a coward at that time, I would never have known the power of God. If I was a coward at that time, I would never have known the presence of God in my life. If you are a coward here tonight, you are not willing to have Jesus because of that old boyfriend, because of that sissy, that effeminate person, and because you are afraid, if I give my life to the Lord, what will my girlfriend say? If you are a coward like that, I pity you. But there's no miracle for the coward. But for the people that will say like Joshua, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Then the miracle is waiting for you. I said the miracle is waiting for you. And so if you have not been born again, if you have been a sinner, give yourself to the Lord, and the Lord will bless you mightily in Jesus' name. If you have been a backslider, the Lord is inviting you, come back home. As you come back home, the Lord himself will receive you, and the power of God will touch your life in a mighty and a dynamic way. And I'm challenging you, if you will give your life to the Lord, the power of God will work in your life. If you have been a believer, you need to make a consecration, a commitment to the Lord. In Romans chapter 8, from verse 35, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? What will separate you from Christ? Will famine separate you from Christ? Is God not able to to take all your poverty away. If you are making a decision to serve the Lord, look at what will be the result in verse 37. Nay, in all these things, we are more than conquerors. Through him that loved us, you will be more than a conqueror. If you will make up your mind that you will not go to those, you will not go back to those dry places of religion. You will not go to, back to those places, they call them churches, where they sin, and they never preach being born again, and they never tell people how to live a righteous life. The pastor himself living in adultery and fornication. If you make up your mind, you will be with the people of God, where the word of God is preached without fear, without favor, and you will stand on the word of righteousness, you will be more than a conqueror. If you are not a coward, if you are not somebody that will say, well, my daddy, my mommy, they gave birth to me in that dry religion, in that useless religion. If you will not say that, if you will say, now I have known the truth, and I want to be in the truth, and I want to live in the truth, and I want to worship God in spirit and in truth, you will be more than a conqueror. God will provide for you. God will meet all your needs, and he will give you miracles in Jesus' name. Let's rise up. I'll give you a chance to prove whether you are a coward or you are bold. Whether you want to go back to your evil practices or you want to stay with Christ. Whether you want to still keep on going to the bar beach and wearing white garments and burning candle and burning incense. Or you want to stand with the Lord Jesus Christ and let the blood of Jesus wash you whiter than snow. Choose you this day whom you will serve. And say and tell the Lord, as for me and my house, as for me and my house, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Are you rejecting Jesus the Savior? Are you a coward? You cannot stand for righteousness? You cannot stand for the truth? Are you still going to go back to idol worship, to the juju men, and to the evil, sinful habits of your life? Be bold for Christ. Be bold, don't be a coward. Call upon the name of the Lord. Let him receive you, and you receive him as well. In Jesus' name we pray. If you have not been born again, if you have been living in sin, but now you are making up your mind that you want to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, I'm going to give you a challenge. I've told you, if you're a coward, you'll never get to heaven. If you're a coward, you'll never be able to receive a miracle from the hand of the Lord. If you're fearing what that false prophet will say, if you're fearing what your family religion will do with you, if you're fearing what the herbalists will say, if you are fearing what your relatives will say, as a coward, God has no miracle for you. But if you are bold and you are saying, I don't care what people say, I don't care what people think, I want Jesus to be my Savior, I want the blood of Jesus to cleanse me, I want a place in heaven to be reserved for me, and I do not care what anybody will think about me or say about me. If you are there, you have not been born again, and you want to be born again and give your life to the Lord Jesus Christ, I'm waiting for those who are not cowards to raise up your hand. You want to be born again, you have not been born again, you want your sins to be taken away, and you are going to leave all those evil things, you are going to leave all that dry religion, you are going to leave all that white garment, all that candle, all that incense, all that juju, all that herbalism, and you want to be bold for the Lord Jesus Christ, and you are saying, yes Lord, Jesus is now my Savior. Yes Lord, I'm turning away from my sin. Yes Lord, I want to give myself completely to the Lord. Wherever you are, just raise up your hand. As for raising up your hand, confess all those sins to the Lord and say, Lord, forgive me. I come back home. Receive me, Lord. Take away all my iniquity. I surrender myself unto you. I believe Jesus died for me on the cross of Calvary. Receive him now. He says, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in unto him, and he'll have fellowship with you. I'll pray with you now. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for all these people. I pray that as they give their lives to the Lord Jesus Christ, all their sins will be forgiven in Jesus' name. Have mercy upon them, O Lord. Wipe all their sins away. Give them the joy of salvation and give them victory in their lives in Jesus' name. Thank you, because I know you have answered. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Whatever your problem, I'm going to pray for you. And as I pray for you, I believe that the power of God is going to touch you. Wait a minute before I pray for you. I told you, I don't want to waste time with cowards. I want to be serious here tonight with the people that want to serve the Lord. Those who will say like Joshua, as for me and my house, who will serve the Lord. And I want to be direct with you. If you're still going to those places where the pastors and the preachers are deceiving you, and you're living in sin and confessing sin every Sunday, and they will never tell you how to be born again and how to live right, you're not worshiping God aright. If you're still going to those places where the false prophets are just taking your money, and they will not read the Bible and interpret the Bible to you and make you to come under the conviction of the Holy Ghost, and that's where you are going every Sunday, you are not worshiping God aright. If you are going to the places where they will never challenge you for the sins you are committing, where they will never talk about Jesus the Savior and Lord, where they will never talk about the grace of God that has appeared unto all men, that is able to make us live a life above sin, if that's the place you are going, you are not worshiping God. You are wasting your time. That's why I want you to make up your mind tonight. If you are afraid, if you are a coward, and they will say, well, if I die, and they will say in that other church, I didn't pay my church due, they will not bury me. If you want, if all you are looking for is burial, after they are buried, you want to go to hell, you want to go back there, good luck to you. I'm talking to people that are reasonable. The people that want to serve the Lord. The people that want to keep with the Lord and with the children of God, and will say, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Before I pray for your healing, before I pray for your prosperity, I want that consecration from you. How many of you are going to remain with the Lord, with the family of God, with the people of God? I'm waiting for you to raise up your hand. How many of you are saying like Joshua, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord? I want you to raise up your hand. I'm waiting for you. If you want to be bold for the Lord, be among the children of God. Father, in the name of Jesus, all these signs that are raised up, they are promising you that they will worship you, that they will serve you, that they will not go back to idol worship, they will not go back into any unprofitable religion, they will not go back into any of these white garment deceivers. They want to serve you. They want a place in heaven. They want a place among your children. They want to serve in spirit and in truth. Oh Lord, I pray you will confirm their commitment and consecration in Jesus' name. You devil, you cannot oppress these people anymore. You devil, you cannot knock these people anymore, because they totally belong to the Lord. They have come out of the kingdom of darkness, they are in the kingdom of the dear Son Jesus Christ. They have come out of dry religion. They have come out all the useless places they have been going before. Now they want to be light in the work of God, in the house of God. Accept them in Jesus' name. Lord, I pray all the shackles and all the chains that tied them before, in all those places where you did not manifest your presence and power, break all the chains, all the shackles in Jesus' name. And I pray you open the windows of heaven, and you'll pour a blessing upon them. until they will not be able to receive the blessings in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, because I know you have answered. In Jesus' name I pray. What I made you do now is what I did many years ago. Heads bowed and eyes closed. When I grew up with my parents, I was going to a church. They never told us about Jesus the Savior. They never told us about being born again. They never told us about how to get into heaven. They never told us about eternal life. Everything was dry. Everything was totally dry. But one day I said, God, where are you? I want to worship you. I want to serve you. I came out of that dry religion. But I made a mistake. I went astray. I went to a place they were burning candle and burning incense and wearing white garments. The adultery there was terrible. They were almost committing that adultery in the church building. I said, God, this is not the place where I will die. Take me out of this place. And God answered my prayer. I heard about being born again. I gave my life to the Lord. I made a consecration and commitment. I said, Lord, I'm not coming back to this white garment place anymore. I'm not coming back to this candle burning, incense burning anymore. And the Lord brought me out. That's why you see me here today. Suppose I was a coward. Suppose I did not obey the Lord. Suppose I did not consecrate myself to the Lord. All the miracles that have been happening, how will they happen? But I thank God I came out. I thank God I came out. I thank God I came out. Now if you are sick, I'm going to pray for you. Your sickness will vanish away. Your poverty will vanish away. Your problems will vanish away. You know, God loves the people that are bold. And you are bold. You have been bold tonight. God loves you. God has no time for cowards. And as you have given yourself to the Lord, I'm going to pray for you. And the miracle power of God will touch you in a mighty way. If you are sick, just lay your hand on the place you are sick. If there is any problem, just lay your hand upon yourself. And that problem is vanishing away here tonight. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for that individual that has been suffering from heart attack. I pray right now, that heart disease vanish away in Jesus' name. I pray for that person that is so weak, almost dying. Oh Lord, I pray your mighty power and the healing virtue of the Lord will pass into the body of that individual in Jesus' name. Oh Lord, I pray for that individual that is said will have to perform an operation. Oh Lord, that operation will not be necessary. I pray that you manifest your power, you manifest your glory, and take that foreign object away from the body of that individual in Jesus' name. I pray for that woman over there that is barren and has been looking up to the Lord for many years and saying, Lord, Lord, when shall it be? The time has come. Oh Lord, I pray that you'll take the barrenness away from her in Jesus' name. That person that is hearing noise in your ear all the time and you are terrified, always looking back, and you are oppressed of the devil, that noise coming from the devil, I challenge you, I command you, come out in Jesus' name. There's another individual there that already you have in a case. You do not know head or tail about that case. But wicked people, evil people, they try to rob you into trouble. And you have been crying and you have nobody to help you. But God is there to help you. God is there to deliver you. Oh Lord, I pray that case, you cancel it in Jesus' name. That person that is owing a lot of debt, I pray right now. Almighty God, I pray that you'll open the windows of heaven and you'll pour your mighty blessings upon that individual in Jesus' name. I pray that the debt that person is owing, your mighty provision will pay for that person in Jesus' name. For those who are out of job, I'm praying for them. That Lord, this month, you'll find job and you'll provide job for all of them in Jesus' name. That person that is having heat all over the body, I pray right now. The heat will vanish away in Jesus' name. That person that has somebody in the hospital, somebody very dear and very close to you, and you have been very, very afraid what will happen. Lord, I pray right now that your mighty power, your healing virtue will go to the hospital and meet that person and flow through that person in Jesus' name. Touch all the people that are sick here tonight. Manifest your power upon their body, upon their lives, upon their families, upon their children. Do it for them in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, because I know you have answered. In Jesus' name I pray. I want you to thank the Lord that you know God has answered you. Praise the name of the Lord that he has answered you.